Joining the program now is Niall Ferguson. He is a professor, British historian, professor, and television host of a documentary series based on his books, and he has written several. His specialty is financial and economic history, particularly hyperinflation and the bond market, so obviously very relevant to what is happening today. His most recent book is titled Civilization, The West and the Rest. He is also contributing editor to Financial Times. Been doing that since October of 2007. He also writes for Newsweek. He teaches at Harvard College and the London School of Economics. He teaches a course entitled Western Ascendancy, The Mainsprings of Global Power from 1600 to the Present. Niall, welcome to the show. You know, in looking at the title of your course, you know, one of the arguments I've been having a lot recently with economists and even with some of the protesters down on Occupy Wall Street is their version of why it is the West rose to power. They don't think it was because of freedom or capitalism. They think it was because the government finally got involved, that we got labor unions and we got all these social safety nets and protections, and it was government and taxation that led to our prosperity rather than capitalism. How say you?
Well, they couldn't be more wrong, could they? The story of Western ascendancy, and I mean by the West not only the United States, but the part of the world that ultimately created it, Europe, this ascent really starts in about 1500, and it's propelled not by governments, but by trading companies, merchant adventurers, people who were the ultimate risk takers, the kind of guys who would get in boats and sail across uncharted oceans in search of profits, Portuguese explorers and merchants like Vasco da Gama. So it starts with a competitive struggle for trade. And the governments play only a relatively minor part in that they will sanction and sometimes finance these expeditions. But you couldn't really regard Christopher Columbus as some kind of government functionary. The market is the driver. That is the thing that distinguishes the West from the rest for centuries. By comparison, China, which in, say, 1400 was clearly the richest place in the world, has a highly centralized bureaucracy, which any ambitious person has to join through an examination. And merchants, guys who do business, are practically the bottom of the social scale, below peasants. So I think that tells you all you need to know, actually, about the role of capitalism versus the role of government in the rise of the West. If you just take the very long run view, in, say, 1500, the average inhabitant of China was richer than the average inhabitant of North America by quite some margin. By the time you get to the 1970s, which is kind of the peak of the global imbalance, the average American is more than 20 times richer than the average Chinese. And if you do it in current dollar terms, it's more like 70 times. This was not just a benefit that flowed to the 1%. This was the average American who was richer by a factor of 70 than the average Chinese. The Chinese, of course, had spent half a century experimenting with communism, and the results had been catastrophic. Millions, tens of millions of people dead in Mao's man-made famine. So, you know, we got to tell the story, I think, with some historical accuracy here. And many, I think, historians of the left make the mistake of telling the story of the West's rise purely in terms of economic exploitation, slavery, expropriation of indigenous peoples. I don't deny those things. In fact, I write in some detail about them. But the point that I make is that they don't explain the success of the West. It wasn't actually empire that made the West strong. Empire was the least original thing that Westerners did.
Absolutely. In fact, you can argue economically that the United States, for example, would have been better had there never been slavery. I think that had we had free labor in which the plantation owners actually paid people to work and they had incentives to work because they enjoyed the fruits of their labor and they didn't have to pay for their clothing, their health care, their food, I think we would have been more successful and more prosperous.
Right. The most successful part of the U.S. economy is the industrial North, not the slaveholding South. That, of course, is why the North wins the Civil War. And if you go right back to the origins of the United States, to the colonial era, there's already a divergence between the model that they adopt, say, in Virginia, and the model that they adopt in Massachusetts. And the Massachusetts model, which is essentially based on free labor and on free enterprise, is more successful. No, I think you're absolutely right. We need to recognize that although there is a shadow side to the history of the last 500 years of Western dominance, it is not that which is most important.
And the biggest irony, though, is as you're explaining how we so dominated China, for example, that we were 70 times richer, and China had this failed experiment with socialism. The irony of it is we're now adopting those failed policies. China's learned their lesson. They're now moving in our direction, and we're seeing that gap narrow dramatically. And unfortunately, I think that, you know, maybe even before the end of the decade, you could actually see the Chinese eclipse the U.S. And once again, where the average Chinese citizen could be wealthier than the average American.
What is certainly going to happen is that within about 5 years, China's economy will become the biggest in the world. And that's not my projection. That's the International Monetary Fund's. It says that China's GDP will overtake that of the U.S. in 2016. Now, of course, in per capita terms, they still have a long way to go. You know, the Chinese middle class is more than 50 million people right now, with more than $10,000 a year. And pretty soon it'll be more like 200 million. They're going to have the biggest middle class in the world.
And it's not the government that is responsible for that middle class. When the government was in charge, there was no middle class. It's
correct.
It's freedom. It's capitalism. And they're doing this without Social Security, without Medicare, without all these social programs that we think are so crucial to creating a middle class. China doesn't have them, and they're running circles around us. In fact, I think, did you have a debate with Paul Krugman about this a couple years ago?
I've been arguing with Paul Krugman for more than 2 years that the United States is on a completely unsustainable fiscal trajectory towards bankruptcy, and that we have to address this issue now rather than in some indeterminate future, because we risk finding ourselves at some point, who knows when, but at some point in the situation that Italy is today, losing credibility in the eyes of international markets and suddenly going from paying, let's say, less than 3% on a 10-year bond to paying 7%. And when that happens, you are in a death spiral. Just watch what's happening in Italy. A year ago, no expert would have said, oh, Italy's going to get into this kind of trouble. They were worried about Greece then. But my point is that fiscal arithmetic applies to you, whoever you are. It doesn't matter if you're Greek, Italian, or an American. If you end up borrowing something like 100% of your GDP, and by the way, half of that borrowing is from abroad, and if you end up running a $1 trillion deficit every year for the rest of time, at some point the markets call time. And when they do, it's brutal. It's really, really
well, especially stuff. When you consider that we're actually running deficits of $1.5 trillion. I think we're headed for $2 trillion deficits by next year, and our debt to GDP is already 100% now, with the national debt at $15 trillion, and that doesn't count all the unfunded liabilities. And as you're saying, I point out all the time, we're financing this with treasury bills. 40% of the debt, I think, is coming due in the next year, all of it is short term. And if rates go up, We're Italy, we're Greece. I mean, how could we afford to pay 8%, 7-8% interest on this national debt? We can't.
Well, this is a real nightmare scenario. Now, short term, it looks like Krugman is right, because with all the panic in Europe, investors pile into treasuries and the yields don't move. And his response to that is, you see, we can borrow even more. We should have another huge stimulus. And my sense is that if you believe the markets have that kind of foresight, presumably you were long mortgage-backed securities in early 2007. Markets are myopic. They focus on one thing at a time. Right now, the crisis is Italy. There is no reason at all why, at some point in the next, let's say, 2 years, the attention shouldn't shift to the United States, especially since American politicians specialize in drawing attention to the country's fiscal problems with things like the debt ceiling fiasco. And we're going to get another of those when this super committee reveals a totally worthless
series
of recommendations.
Of all the stupid things that we did, we actually officially acknowledged that we were running a Ponzi scheme. And, you know, a lot of people here in the U.S., in academia, on Wall Street, think that we've got nothing to worry about in the United States, that we're never going to have any kind of sovereign debt crisis like they're having in Greece or in Italy, because we've got a printing press. Do you think that our creditors should take solace in the fact that we have a printing press and therefore have no concerns over the level of debt that we have?
Well, of course, it's some pretty miserable consolation. Hey, relax, everybody. We can always debase the currency. From a Chinese vantage point, this is especially disturbing. They worry about this a great deal. In fact, one of the number one conversations you have in Beijing is, are the Americans going to print away their liabilities to us? And the best-selling book in Beijing in economics is called Currency Wars, and it's all about that question. So they're watching it very closely. The lesson of history is that inflation expectations can move in a very nonlinear way. One minute, people are not worried, and the next minute, their expectations change. And that is, I think, the kind of thing we need to be worried about, as well as the Chinese.
Absolutely. I mean, from my perspective, there's only two things that we can do with our debt. We can default on it or inflate it away. But actually paying it off isn't even in the realm of possibility. Do you think that the U.S. is in better shape, let's say, than Japan or Europe? Or would you say the U.S. is in worse shape?
I think it's in better shape, broadly speaking, in that we still have certain edges over the rest of the world. We're still the technological innovator par excellence. We still have the best universities in the world, and that's closely linked to the success of places like Silicon Valley. We still have an entrepreneurial culture, which is second to none, and we still have among, I would say, the ordinary American people, a strong predisposition for free market solutions, for enterprise over government solutions. But what worries me is that Washington and the parasitical interest groups that surround it are setting the country on a course that will blow those advantages away by creating so many fiscal burdens and so many uncertainties that these advantages stop being decisive. That's the big danger that we face. Now, it's not at this point beyond being salvaged. The message of my book, Civilization, is that we can turn this around. But we do need to get back to the fundamental institutional basics that made this country great. And at the moment, I feel as if the political class, and this applies not only to Democrats, has lost sight of what those basic institutional advantages were.
What about, though, from a fiscal perspective, just the level of debt that we have, the fact that it's owed to foreigners, the fact that we have these enormous trade deficits and current account deficits, that we have very little domestic savings, the short-term nature of our national debt? Do you think we might be facing a bigger fiscal time bomb or monetary crisis than potentially Europe or Japan?
When you look at the term structure of the debt, what that is to say, the point you make that it's very short-term on average, that when you look at the tax base, which is actually pretty small relative to the size of the debt, then the U.S. starts to look dreadful. In fact, I think it was Morgan Stanley that pointed out that the fiscal position of the United States, if you take debt to revenue, debt to tax revenue, was as bad as that of Greece, maybe even worse. So if you measure debt in a way that I think is meaningful, in other words, if you relate the debt to the available tax revenues, the U.S. is actually in one of the worst positions in the world. And that's why I think the time bomb is real, because we are basically on course to devote, by the middle of the century, if you just follow the Congressional Budget Office projections, 100% of tax revenues to interest payments, even if interest rates stay low, as people like Paul Krugman say they will. So this is a totally unsustainable fiscal policy we currently have, and the political class seems incapable of coming up with a credible plan to get to stability any time in that 10, 20, or 30-year period. And when anybody else comes up with the plan, whether it's Paul Ryan or Simpson Bowles, it gets shot down in flames within minutes.
That tax base is important, because I don't like when people just look at debt to GDP, because you forget in America, our GDP is 70% spending. It's a lot of fluff. It's a lot. It's not a lot of wealth-producing manufacturing. And if interest rates spike up, then that part of our GDP implodes. And so as rates rise, our GDP is contracting, and the debt service is exploding through the roof. And that's a dynamic that's going to accelerate on itself and be a self-perpetuating spiral.
Exactly. This is the real danger. And as a financial historian who spent most of his career working on these problems, the thing that impresses me is that you're fine until you're not fine. You can run a great big deficit and have a mountain of debt, and everybody can seem absolutely fine with it, until suddenly expectations change. Suddenly a bit of negative news takes on enormous proportion in the minds of investors, and the spreads start to move. In other words, your borrowing costs start to edge up, and it can just be a few basis points. But once you get into that debt spiral, as Italy right now is, I mean, Italy has got into this situation within the last few months. it is a very, very hard process to stop because the rising borrowing costs make the deficit worse. You then have to take emergency fiscal measures that make the economy shrink. And that is essentially the scenario that we need to worry about. And we can sometimes just miss the scale of a problem until we suddenly see it. And then, oh, God, we go from greed to fear. And that's the problem.
Anyway, hey, thanks for being on the show. You're a great guest.